winners on, I mean, it's 8 a.m. basically.
8 a.m., yeah, it's early in the morning, yes.
I'm impressed.
You're excited to hear from Sarah? If you're ready, say ready. Very good. Go ahead and take a seat. Go ahead and take a seat. So is there anything you want to say to welcome a hometown crowd here?
I mean, you got to love Hotlanta. This is where I started it. This is an awesome place to be if you're an entrepreneur.
That's right. So you've always been entrepreneurial. And right. And so what gave you the initial idea to start the company that everyone knows that you have, which is Spanx? So how did you get started?
Well, you know, everybody always talks about the moment that I cut the feet out of my pantyhose to solve an undergarment issue that didn't exist as the way that Spanx started. But it actually, I'm going to back up a little bit in my story and talk about a part that isn't written about very much, which is Spanx started when I was selling fax machines door to door. Another, okay. Anybody that does door-to-door, I mean, it was really intense. So I was doing that for 7 years in Clearwater, Florida, and I was getting business cards ripped up in my face. I was being escorted out of buildings, and it was a really just difficult time in my life. And one day I pulled off the side of the road, and I thought, I'm in the wrong movie. Like, cut, call the producer, call the director. This is not my life. This is not my life. And so I went home that day, and I wrote down what I thought I was good at. And the only thing in the good column was sales. And I said to myself, okay, why am I good at sales? What is it about sales that I love? And I loved offering something to someone that maybe helped them, made their life easier or better, or was something that they needed. And I decided, okay, in that moment, I want to sell something that I love and that I'm passionate about. What, you know, I'm selling fax machines, and so that wasn't something I was passionate about. And in that moment, I wrote down in my journal, I'm going to invent a product that I can sell to millions of people that will make them feel good. And then I literally specifically said out loud to the universe, I said, please give me the idea. And it was 2 years later that I was going to a party here in Atlanta. I was 27 at the time that I cut the feet out of control top pantyhose to wear under white pants to solve an issue that I didn't want to see the panty lines or the thong and everything else going on under the pants. And when I got home that night, I thought, this could be the idea.
How many of you enjoy selling? Yes? How many of you do not enjoy selling? So what is it about selling that you actually enjoy that you think most people don't enjoy selling? So what is it about selling that you actually enjoy?
Well, okay, this is the first thing I'm going to say. If you don't like selling, you should really take the time for yourself to practice it and learn it, because all of life is sales. I mean, whether you're an accountant, whether you're a stay-at-home mother and you're trying to sell your kids on why they need to go to bed at a certain time or they need to do something that you need them to do. In an interview, you have to sell yourself. I mean, and so I think it's really important to be able to do that. And hardcore door-to-door sales was incredible groundwork and laid the foundation for me to be able to do Spanx. Because when I started Spanx, the first 2 years that I was cold calling all the manufacturers in North Carolina, I only heard one word. No.
Yeah.
I mean, no, no, no. And because I had training and just knew I'm going to keep going till I get that yes, that's the reason that I was able to get through that stage.
2 years.
Yeah.
2 years worth of no's.
Yeah.
And so what, in that evolution of starting the company, obviously you have to take risk in order to be successful in anything you do. And most people are afraid of risk. But what is one of the biggest business risks that you've taken that scared you or created some anxiety for you?
Well, definitely starting Spanx was my biggest career and financial risk that I took. I had $5,000 set aside in my savings from selling fax machines door to door, and I used that to start the company. And I will mention that being an entrepreneur is about taking risks, but it's about taking very calculated risks and being, you know, protecting the downside. So I didn't quit my job selling fax machines until I had already invented the product. I was working on it at night and on the weekends for 2 years. I was driving around North Carolina, where most hosiery was made, begging a bunch of manufacturing plants to help make it. And I didn't quit my job until I had already landed Neiman Marcus, Saks Fifth Avenue, and got a call from Oprah.
Just a typical day.
Then I was like, okay, I feel confident to quit, but I needed the income that was coming in and I needed my healthcare benefits. And I was working out of my apartment in Virginia Highlands, and I ran Spanx out of my apartment for 2.5 years. And it was crazy. I mean, I had semi-trucks pulling up twice a week to this apartment, and my neighbors were like, what's happening? What's going on? But I was so conservative with my finances in the beginning. I was very scrappy, and still am really scrappy.
Yeah, very good. Yeah. So most people don't have the tenacity to continue moving through a process of 2 years or 2.5 years because there's so many obstacles that take place. And most people quit before they get to an aha moment of a business where you go, hey, this actually has been worth the 2.5 years.
Yeah.
When did the aha moment or the realization come to you that women are actually going to love Spanx?
When I saw my own butt in the product. I was like, whoa, this works. I didn't have focus groups. I wasn't seeking a lot of outside opinions. I always say that an idea is its most vulnerable in the moment that you have it. And it's also human nature that in the moment that we have an idea, we want to turn to our coworker, our friend, our husband, our wife, and say, here's my idea. And I didn't do that. I did not seek validation for my product. I did pursue it. So I told, you know, manufacturing plants, I told patent and lawyers my idea. Anybody that could help move my idea forward, I was sharing it with. But mom, dad, friends, and I have the best family and friends, I kept it to myself. And no one told me to do that. It was an intuition. And I just, at that point, I didn't want ego to have to get involved in the process too early. And I didn't want to have to spend the time defending and explaining my idea. I wanted to spend the time pursuing it. And I truly believe that had I not done that, Spanx wouldn't exist.
Wow, very good. Give her a hand. There's a lot of wisdom in what you just said. First of all, where did you learn to move ego out of the way, number one? And number two, you said something. You said the idea is most vulnerable in the moment. An idea is most vulnerable in the moment, and oftentimes it can die right away. So where did you learn that?
Everybody in their life has $1 million or maybe even $1 billion idea at some point in your life. And a lot of times they just come and go because I waited a full year, and then once I was ready, I'd put enough of my own sweat equity into the process that I was trusted that I wouldn't quit. I sat my family and friends down, you know, and then of course, out of love and concern, I heard, well, sweetie, if it's such a good idea, why doesn't it already exist? Or, okay, honey, well, you're gonna do this, you're gonna spend your savings on it, and even if it did take off, the big guys will knock you out of the water in 6 months, and then you won't have your savings. So had I heard that, I think the day that I cut the feet out of my pantyhose to go to the party, I probably would still be, I guess, well, not selling fax machines. I don't even know if they're around anymore, but I'd be selling something else door to door still, and would not have invented something for myself.
Right, very good. And so I think most people will hear your story, although recognize, you know, you on a cover or on the Oprah show, and sometimes they don't realize that even in that process of the journey that there's a lot of tough times and there's a lot of tough moments that come and go.
Yeah.
So if you'd be willing to share, what have been some of the tough times in the evolution of Spanx that have hit you, and how did you deal with them?
Well, okay, so I'll start when I'm 16 briefly, and you had asked about how I learned to move ego out of the process. Well, this has something to do with that. When I was 16 years old, I was riding a bike with one of my very close friends, and she was run over and killed by a car in front of me. And then literally a few months later, my parents separated and my dad left home and moved out. And when my dad was moving out, I was just a complete wreck at this point in my life. Being 16 is hard enough, and you know, to watch someone die in front of me and then have my family split up. My father walked in and he handed me a cassette tape series of Wayne Dyer. And the series was How to Be a No Limit Person. And he said, sweetie, I wish that I was your age when I discovered this instead of the age of 40. And then he moved out. And I had a few options at that age, you know, to either numb myself and self-destruct at that time, which I contemplated, or listen to these tapes. And I started listening to the tapes so much that I had memorized all 10 tapes front and back. And it became a running joke with all my friends in high school. They were always like, do not get stuck in her car after a party because she's going to make you listen to that crap. I mean, I always had it playing in my car, but it just opened up my eyes because I wasn't that engaged in school. I found school very frustrating, and I wasn't the most talented student. I was always, you know, a little bit distracted and couldn't really focus great in school. And I realized everyone's teaching me what to think. I'm spending all day every day in school and no one's teaching me how to think. And so Wayne Dyer and those tapes were the first time that I had ever been taught how to think. And the brain is one of our most powerful assets. And how our brain functions is a huge factor on how our life ends up. And so learning about the power of positive thinking, manifestation, visualization, the law of attraction, all of these things were coming into my life as a 16-year-old, and it just made sense to me. And so that's one big obstacle. And I always say in everything that we go through in our life, there's always a hidden blessing. There always is. And for me, in that really dark time, Wayne Dyer coming into my life was my hidden blessing, because a typical 16-year-old, I'm not sure, would listen to those tapes over and over again. You know, it was this like middle-aged man with a bushy mustache and his hand under his chin, like bald. And, you know, I probably would have thrown it in my closet. But at that point, it was the perfect storm for me to say, I'm hungry for this. And then throughout Spanx, you know, just always hearing the word no and persevering. This is the deal. If you're doing something that hasn't been done before or you want to really make change, you have to expect the word no and you have to expect resistance and that people think you're crazy. If people don't think you're crazy and you don't hear the word no, you're really not breaking ground. So don't worry about it if you're hearing that. You know, so I heard a lot of no. I made a lot of fumbles along the way, you know, through manufacturers. That one manufacturer went out of business and only gave me a week's notice and almost put Spanx completely out of business, and I had to scramble to figure. I mean, literally just owning a business is dealing with obstacles.
Right.
All day, every day. That's what it is. It's like, how am I going to take this lemon and turn it into lemonade and then take it a step further and make a lemonade stand and then sell the lemon lemonade with it?
That's right. Well, I think that's powerful to be able to move through it and be inspired. You have a room full of crazy people, I think, yes? Crazy people, yeah. Room full of crazies here that love to learn, love to lead, and love to influence other people. And so so what's been one of your proudest professional accomplishments to date?
I would say when I got an opportunity to give Oprah $1 million, I surprised her and gave her $1 million on her show for... thank you. For her Leadership Academy for Girls in Africa. And women's education and entrepreneurship for women is really deeply important to me. And so the fact that, you know, Oprah chose Spanx as her favorite product of the year when I was working out of my apartment in Atlanta and had no money to advertise, I had sent her a gift basket with the product and a heartfelt note, and she ended up putting it on and has worn it almost every day since, some form of Spanx. And so to be able to fast forward and be on her show many years later and hand her that check and surprise her was really cool. And then also the Giving Pledge, you know, signing the Giving Pledge in the last, I think, 4 or 5 years, and joining Bill Gates and Warren Buffett and all these unbelievable world-changing philanthropists has been an incredible moment.
Yeah, too. So for those of you or for the people that may not understand what the Giving Pledge is, could you elaborate a little bit more on what is it, what does it represent, and what inspired you to want to be a part of that?
Sure. So the Giving Pledge is Warren Buffett and Bill and Melinda Gates decided to create a organization called the Giving Pledge and encourage people that were very, very successful to pledge to donate half their wealth or more to make the world a better place. And they have 100, and I think it's up to 160 pledgers now. And it's an incredible group of people that are literally changing the planet. I mean, Bill and Melinda are eradicating polio. And I just want to mention this as a woman. I don't know if any other women out there have this, but as a woman, I had a lot of struggle with, you know, inner dialogue about wanting to achieve enormous success financially. And I say this because it's really important for everyone to check in. That's why I say our brain is really our most powerful tool. You know, people ask me all day, every day, can I have 10 minutes of your time? I want to hear how you started Spanx. Within about 5 to 10 minutes of talking to people when I have the chance, I can tell if they're going to be successful or not, just because I can tell about really their deep attitude about success. Like, do they truly believe they're worthy of it? Do they truly have a positive feeling about money and achieving financial success? And doing that work on yourself is important. You know, you deserve it, you earn it. And for me, part of my path of wanting to feel like that was okay and a really great goal for me to have for myself was the opportunity to give it away. And so, you know, it's always been about, for me, how I can help women, how I can serve women. And so I always say, if you're on a journey and you can find something other than yourself that's bigger than yourself that you care about, you'll find more courage than you thought you had. And so the platform for me wasn't like, oh, I want to just invent Spanx and just have tons of money. It was like, how can I help women? How can I elevate women and empower women? And then the day I cut the feet out of my pantyhose, I was like, cool, this might be the way that I do it.
That's right.
So signing the Giving Pledge was because I feel so grateful to be a woman born in the exact right time in the exact right country. I mean, I looked at my mom and my grandmother, and they weren't given as many options, and I had a quiet sadness growing up for them about that. I could feel that, and I absorbed that as a girl and now a woman. And so it never was lost on me that only by 20 years, my mom's 22 when she had me, and that difference, and think of how long we've been on the planet, mm-hmm. just by 20 to 40 years, I made the cut of being a woman able to have more options to fulfill my potential.
Right, yeah, very good. Give her a hand. Well, obviously, there's a lot of conditions that go into allowing someone to become who they're predestined to become, and for people to believe in that and grow through it and go through all the obstacles. And along the way, besides the Wayne Dyer tape and some other people that were there, what's some of the best advice, either personal or professional, that someone's given to you that's helped you move along through the process?
Well, that's a great question. I would say, for me, it was my father. He used to encourage me to fail. And so growing up at the dinner table, he would ask my brother and me what we had failed at that week. And if I didn't have something, he would be disappointed. And so I can remember coming home and saying, Dad, I tried out for this and I was horrible. And he'd go, way to go, and high five me. And, you know, at the time I was like, what is my dad doing? But I realized he was teaching me and he was redefining my definition of failure. So through that practice and the gift that my dad gave me of actually encouraging me to go try things even though I thought I would fall on my face, failure, the only failure for me is not trying instead of the outcome.
Yeah, very good. Failure is not trying, yes? Hello, yes? Yeah, very good. You need to move through the process. When did you realize the advice that your dad was giving to you was actually helpful as opposed to, like, you didn't... At first, you didn't realize what it was doing, but then you said that you realized what it was doing. When did that occur?
I mean, it occurred to me in high school when I would observe really dear friends of mine that wouldn't do things. And when I would say, well, why aren't you doing it? They'd be like, well, I don't know if I'm going to be good at it, or I'm afraid to fail. And so I realized that was so crippling and brought so many people, stopped them in their tracks from trying amazing things. And so that's really when I started observing it. And another thing that, you know, is really important to work on in yourself is not caring about what other people think about you. And that's a hard one. And that's a practice that I'm still, a journey I'm still on. And it's important to learn. What I learned was, by not caring what other people think about me doesn't mean I don't care about them. I care deeply about them and the people I love, but you really need to free yourself of that, especially if you want to chart your own course.
Very good. And so every single day there's opportunities to do things, and every single day there's opportunities to not do things.
Right.
And so what are some daily activities that you do every day that helps you maintain momentum and continue the greatness of what you're doing?
Well, I have 4 children under the age of 8. He turned 8 last week. So time alone is even more sacred, and it's a time that I absolutely need to carve out for myself. So one of the things that I did is I found out when my best thinking time is, and it's in the car. So I live only 5 or 6 minutes from the Spanx headquarters, but I actually many times leave my house an hour before I need to be at work and go on a fake commute. So my friends have laughed and called it my fake commute, but I realize that's when my mind wanders, and And that's when my ideas come to me, and so I have to carve that time out. So I'm driving around with all the other commuters, and I'm like the happy commuter, because I don't ever have an agenda of where I'm going. Sometimes I'm in Inman Park, sometimes I end up in downtown, sometimes I'm in Decatur. I just drive around, and there must be something for me about the activity of driving and being able to think and just listen to some background music that accesses a certain part of my brain. Mm. And I read the other day that Einstein had all his best ideas when he was shaving. And so there must be something about a rote activity that you're doing that allows you to, at least for me, it's driving. So that's one thing that I would say that I do. So find out and identify when your best think time is, and make sure you're making that happen in your life. And I'm not talking about when you're just going through your checklist of everything you have to do. I'm talking about when does your mind wander? And if you don't have enough time carved out in your life for your mind to wander, you're not accessing the best part of yourself, because there's a knowing inside of you, and it's when you're in that space, not when you're watching TV, and not, you know, it's even more difficult now with how much distractions we have from ourselves.
Right.
Yeah, with iPhones and television and children and schedules. But
finding the time to think, and then when you have an idea. So if you're doing that, most people are trying to avoid commuting, and you're actually getting into the commuting. But when you have those ideas, how do you even disseminate which one is a good idea at that moment in time versus the other ones you may have in a different day?
Well, I've always had a notebook with me, the same size notebook with me at all times, and now I still have the notebook with me, but I also now with iPhones, the second I have an idea, I email it to myself, or I log it in notes, or I write it down in a notebook. I mean, the second I have it. So that's really important for me as far as keeping them. And then I go back and revisit them. And right now I have 56 pages, single spaced, of ideas. My team that works with me is, you know, they keep it, and every couple weeks I'll say, can you get out the document? And they know what I'm talking about, and I'll just go through it. And the ones that keep surfacing, like something I did recently was the Belly Art Project. I created a book of pregnant women who we painted their belly wild, amazing objects, and it started with my own belly when I was pregnant with my son, and then I ended up using the book to give all the money to charity, to Christy Turlington's Every Mother Counts. But that idea sat in a drawer for like 3 or 4 years. I took pictures of my own belly. I woke up at 3 in the morning the night before I delivered, 3 days before I delivered my son.
Wow.
And I literally thought, my body's amazing. This is incredible. It may never be in this state again. This is like a beautiful canvas. What can I do? And so I wrote down Mr. Potato Head, basketball, beach ball, and watermelon, and then went back to bed. And the next morning, I called a friend. I said, can you paint all these things on my belly? And I ran around Atlanta, and I literally went into the Kroger on Peachtree with my very pregnant belly painted as a watermelon and put it on top of the watermelon display. And you cannot tell the difference between my belly and the watermelon. So anyway, but that's just one thing that was in the list.
Right.
Of, you know, so some of them are Spanx related, some of them are not at all, and I honor each idea.
All right, very good. And in the room we have some entrepreneurs, and we also have a lot of entrepreneurs in the making, or people that aspire to become an entrepreneur or create a lifestyle for themselves. Mm-hmm. So what kind of tips would you give to someone that is maybe in the beginning stages or an entrepreneur in the making?
Okay. Well, the first thing I want to say to you is what you don't know can be your greatest asset if you have the courage to let it be. So if you don't have experience in it and you have an idea about it, if you know, so often we'll say to ourselves, well, I didn't go to school for that, or I don't have a degree in that, or why would I be the one to cut off feet of my pantyhose and take down an industry when there's billions, you know, billion-dollar companies. So, but what I didn't know actually worked in my advantage. But I had to have the courage to say, don't keep talking to myself and say, try it anyway. Maybe you are the one that knows. And so that will ensure that you're different and do it differently. And every part of the Spanx process, I did it very differently. And it was because I didn't know how it was supposed to be done. So honor that in yourself. Don't second guess yourself and let that beat yourself up. Turn to it and go, this is cool. This is an asset. And then the next thing I would say is, it's really important to differentiate yourself. I say that more than anything. You've got to get to the point, and you've got to give the what's in it for them very concisely and very quickly. So with differentiating yourself, I'll use an example. I always say you've got to differentiate. You've got to tell the person or the world why you're unique and why you're different very clearly and concisely. Then you have to let them know why you're unique and different in comparison to other options they may have. And then you need to let them know why that matters to them. So I'll use my own journey and just give you the example. I also say it's really important to sell the problem you're solving, not just the product. So I'll take my Spanx. So when I first invented Spanx, if I were to plug in this equation and how important it was, the first thing I said to the buyer or anybody, if I was in the media, if I got a chance to be on the news, I would say, do you have, you know how women have things hanging in their closet that we have no idea what to wear under? And then they would nod. And so I immediately started with the problem, creating the problem that I'm now about to solve. Then I would say, and then, you know how our undergarment options, they're not that great. You have regular underwear that leaves a panty line that you can see, or these very thick, heavy-duty girdles that are too thick under your beautiful clothes or your nice slacks and leave lines on your legs, okay? Then I've just given them the options that are dysfunctional, and then I tell them, well, I've just invented this product, and look what it does. It meets in the middle of the options that are out there, and here's why it's going to be important to you. Here's why it's going to matter. You're going to be able to wear white. You're going to be able to wear cream. You're finally going to be able to wear all the fabrics in your closet that you don't wear anymore, and you're going to look amazing. You're going to have no lines. So then I would give the what's in it for them, but that's just a quick example, and I like to start with the problem that I'm solving. Right. Have them just sort of invest in it with you, and then why the other options aren't so great. People need to know from you, you're the only one that can do it, why you're their best choice. Don't assume that they're gonna just try to figure it out. People are busy, people are, we got a lot on our mind. Tell me, even in an interview, when I'm interviewing people, I want them to say, I'm your best candidate and here's why, and be very clear about it.
Right, very good, give her a hand. A lot of wisdom sitting in that. A lot of wisdom. If you could go back and talk to your younger self, go built the time machine and go back and talk to your younger self, what advice would you give the younger you that maybe you didn't realize about yourself that you wish you did when you were younger?
Well, the first thing that pops into my mind is that he shows up.
He shows up.
He shows up.
He shows up.
And I think he's sitting in the audience here. But I spent a lot of time as a younger self worrying about, am I going to meet the right one? Am I going to be able to have children? Am I going to start a family? And I would tell my younger self, just chill out. He shows up. Just do your thing. Don't spend any mental energy on that. But it's hard, especially as a woman. I really wanted to be financially independent. I wanted to chart my own way. But I also was really wanting to be a mother and have another side of my life.
Right.
So that's what I would say.
Very good.
He shows up. He took his time. I didn't get married till I was 37, 38. But now we have four children.
Very good. And in addition to the giving pledge, you also have a leg up initiative. Mm-hmm. Could you tell us a little bit about the leg up initiative? And you've had so much success in your business. Talk about the leg up initiative, then also what is next for you.
Okay. Well, the Leg Up is one of the programs we have. I have a foundation that I'm always trying to figure out how to help entrepreneurs. And the Leg Up program is that we highlight a female entrepreneur's product or service. We choose it and we highlight it in our catalog that goes out to millions of people. And we do it for free. We just give them the space in our catalog. We put them on our website. And it's my way of paying the Oprah moment forward, because she gave me the exposure I so desperately needed at the right time in my career.
Right.
And I didn't have the money to advertise. So that's just one initiative. And if you're interested, you can email spanx.com. And
yeah. If they want more information, where do they go to?
Spanx.com.
Spanx.com.
Yeah. And you have to spell Spanx with an X or you're going to get a real treat.
Some people are viciously trying to figure out what the treat is. Yeah.
I know. My poor mom sent her whole lunch into the wrong website when I first started. I was like, Mom, it's not KS, it's X. Anyway, okay.
So we only have time for one more question. We appreciate you being here. We appreciate you honoring the gift that you have and allowing us to indulge in your story and learn from it and be inspired and be empowered by it.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
But what's the one last parting advice that you'd like to give to people here?
Just believe in yourself. The power of believing in yourself. Keep going. Courage is doing things, despite the fear, not in absence of the fear. And trust your gut. And it's super fun. It's super fun. Enjoy the journey while you're on it. But I do want to mention, can I mention to them that I have two things that I want to offer you guys since I'm here. So if you're interested and you want to try Spanx, a product at Spanx, if you email trymeatspanx, that's all you have to do. You don't even have to put anything in the subject. An email will come right back to you with a code that's specifically just for you to give you 20% off anything on spanx.com that you want. And that will be good for the next 3 or 4 days. So check it out. We have leggings, we have bras, we have activewear, we have men's. I created a very amazing man's undershirt. It's tapered in at the waist. It has a little bit of lycra in it so it doesn't stretch out easily, and it just looks much more tailored under dress shirts.
Yeah, very good.
So men, we got stuff for you too. And then the other thing is I just joined Instagram not that long ago. I think I'm the last one on the planet to join social media, but my team finally convinced me, and I have to tell you, I was scared. I really was. I still have a lot of fear. I'm fear of flying and all kinds of stuff, but I joined Instagram. And so if you go to @SaraBlakely, and that's Sarah without an H, and you put #Tony, because Tony's coming today and he's awesome, in any of my recent posts, I'm sending out free leggings to many different people that I'm going to choose. My team and I are going to choose over the next 2 days, and our leggings are amazing. And if you're a guy and you want something for your wife, we'll do that. But if not, the leggings are amazing. And we have a new invention coming out this fall that I'm really excited about for the arms.
Ooh.
And I'm going to give a few people in this audience something that the public won't get until the fall.
Very good. Well, give her a hand for those free offers, those offers that are there. If you could, Atlanta, please stand up. Please give a big thank you to Sara Blakely.
Thank you
for being here.